Hello guys, welcome to the second part of the series of tutorial that we are making for firmware development on STM32. In this part, we will cover these topics: general CPU building blocks, brief of computer architecture, instruction set architecture versus microarchitecture, RISC versus CISC, and Harvard versus Newman. We will also see computing language translation. How does your high-level code gets compiled into machine language, and how does it get converted into your instruction codes? Then we will have a look at STM32 L4 block diagram as well as its system architecture. We'll also look at memory map, the Cortex CPU itself, pipelining, as well as we'll look into vector table briefly. In the third part, we will be diving into the code, looking at the GPIOs, the clock gating, as well as hardware wiring diagram of the LED, in which we will see how the board has been designed and how the LED placement has been done. Next, we will do the blinking of the LED using the HAL, or hardware abstraction library, that have been provided by STM32. Stay tuned. So we'll start with this basic question: what is a CPU? As we all know, the CPU is an electronic circuit which is responsible for performing your basic arithmetic, logic, controlling, and IO operations, which are fed to it by your instructions. These instructions need to be in your machine language. The basic building blocks of a CPU, if you want to design it yourself in digital logic or maybe synthesize it in VHDL, these are your control unit, registers, cache, buses, and clock. What is a control unit? Control unit is basically an electronic circuitry inside your CPU which is responsible for fetching, decoding, and executing instructions. So what is fetching? Fetching means you have to get the instructions from the memory, and decoding means you have to decode that instruction based on what is there in your instruction set, what does your ISA say, then you have to execute that instruction. So this is the main responsibility of control unit. Then we have the arithmetic logic unit, which is the ALU. So the ALU is where calculations are done and where the decisions are made. Now we have the registers. The registers are basically very high speed memory which is located very close to the CPU. So these are generally used for storing temporary data during processing. There are also registers for holding the current instruction, the next instruction that needs to be executed, which is called program counter. So the program counter is the register which is responsible for holding the address from where the next instruction is to be fetched. There are registers for holding the results of calculation. Then there is something called cache. So cache is cache is a small amount of high speed RAM that is actually our random access memory. It is called random access because it can be accessed in any particular order. This is a typically present on the CPU core itself. So this is the fastest accessible memory that the CPU has. In bigger CPUs like your Intel x86, etc., you have like various levels of cache, like L1, L2, L3. L1 is the closest to the CPU, then there is L2 and L3. So whenever choosing the CPU, you should go for the highest level of L1 cache because that will be the fastest. And these will be like 10 times and 30 times slower than L1. Then there are buses. So buses are like kind of routes for the traffic. Clock. So the clock is basically a regular electric pulse that is used for synchronizing all the components. These are the basic components of a CPU. Next we will see its kind of a graphic version. This is a high level overview of what a generalized CPU should look like. It will have registers, control unit, ALU, cache, and there will be external components. So these external components are your flash memory, and you can also additionally use some other memory like additional NAND flash or something, but these are external components. Then there is your primary memory, which is your RAM. So there are buses for data and address and control. So this is what the overall architecture of a CPU look like. Then we come to something interesting, which is called instruction set architecture. The role of instruction set architecture is like, suppose you have written something in a very high level language like C. How does that get translated into machine code? Like, even if it gets translated into machine code, where does these ones and zeros have to go so that the instructions are decoded properly by your CPU? So this protocol is defined in your ISA. So it typically describes your memory model, your instruction format, what should be the instruction format, types and modes of instructions, then operand registers types and data addressing. This is basically your laying out. It is a protocol for laying out what a particular computer should look like, what should be instruction set, etc. Then the realization of a particular CPU on the basis of an ISA is called implementation. You can choose an ISA and design a CPU based on that. So this is how CPU is designed. So based on complexity of your architecture, we have generally two types of computers. One of them is CISC, which is you can say complex instruction set computer, which has like instructions for everything, like for multiplying, dividing, everything you have instructions. And all of these instructions are generally not used in practical programs. For example, your computers like x86 or Intel based CPUs, they are, or Motorola 68000, these are your CISC based architectures. Then there is RISC. RISC is for reduced instruction set computing. This is like they have typically a lower number of instructions, and a few instructions only can be used to write any kind of program. And the less common instructions are implemented as subroutines. For example, your ARM based CPUs, Spark, Alpha, or PowerPC, these come under this category, RISC. Now we'll see what is a microarchitecture. So exactly, the microarchitecture is the implementation of your ISA. How you implement the particular ISA to form a processor, this is called your microarchitectures. This is a particular microarchitecture based on an ISA, which is kind of centered around this bus. So this is kind of single bus organization, where your ALU and your instruction decoder and control logic, everything relies on a single bus to get the tasks done. Computer architecture is the combination of microarchitecture and instruction set architecture. Laying out your protocols for how everything should look like, including your instruction addressing formats, and actually designing that into a particular CPU. So this this comprises your computer architecture. Based on computer architecture, we have like two types of, generally in production, like we have two types of architectures. We have like von Neumann architecture and Harvard architecture. In von Neumann architecture, the instruction and data are fetched on the same bus. That's why it has performance limits. Instruction fetch cannot occur while there is a data operation. So this kind of architecture limits the performance of the system. Whereas in Harvard architecture, we have different buses for capturing your instructions and data. Instruction is fetched on a different bus and data on a different bus. This is a better architecture, which kind of generally enhances the performance of your CPU. This is the architecture that ARM follows generally. Also in our Cortex M4 CPU, this same Harvard architecture has been followed. Now we'll see the pipelining. Actually, what was the issue in this von Neumann architecture? While there was a data operation going on, you cannot fetch the instructions. This was a bottleneck which limits the performance. To overcome that, we have pipelinings in. While your execution is going on, you can decode the instructions as well as fetch instruction, and also prefetch also. So there is a three-stage prefetch as well as a three-stage pipeline. This kind of architecture allows very enhanced performance. The performance gets enhanced because you have already kind of cached the instructions which need to be executed next, and also there is a three-stage pipeline in which the execution is being carried out simultaneously, decoding is happening, and instructions are being fetched. Now we will see what is how the computing language gets translated. So basically, you have high level language, it is compiled to assembly using your compiler, and then using assembler it is converted into machine language, which is then flashed into your MCU microcontroller. Based on that, your instructions are fetched and the program runs. Now we will go to this our Cortex-M processor that we have, microcontroller. This is STM32L476. As you can see, these are the IP blocks that are on the silicon die. These are on the die, out of which only this is provided by ARM. So this is ARM specific, and these are other things are vendor specific. For example, if ST is the vendor, so it can decide, okay, I don't want these many timers, I want only four timers, or I don't want display drivers, I want a USB driver or something like that. Based on market orientation or target, they place these blocks or IP blocks on the die, but this remains generally the same. This is your ARM Cortex-M4 with CPU with FPU and up to 80 MHz clock speed. This also controls. This also contains an MPU, which is a memory protection unit, which we'll discuss later. And it also has an ATM for debug purposes. Also, it has DMA, an art accelerator for graphics. For example, if you are doing some graphics on LCD. So for that purposes, it also enhances the performance. Then you have up to 1 MB of flash with ECC, which is error correction, and the flash is in dual banks. We'll see that in the memory map. And also there is a RAM, which is 128 KB. Then there are IOs. In our case, the LQFP64 package has 64 pins, so we have 64 IOs. And then there are blocks for digital. Then there are connectivity blocks. For connectivity, you have OTG, SPI, I2C, etc. And for digital, you have TRNG. And also, parallel interface is present. For example, you want to connect to NAND flash or NOR flash. So you can do that using FSM, so which is flexible static memory controller. Now we will see what is the block diagram of this microcontroller. The main thing is this EHB bus matrix, which is used for arbitration resolution. Now your main clock, which is 80 MHz, is here on this bus. It is transmitted. So this is your EHB1, which is 80 MHz. Now if you come down, there is a bridge, which is EHB APB bridge. There are basically two buses, which is advanced high performance bus and advanced peripheral bus. High performance bus is used for your the main clock, which is up to 80 MHz, and peripheral bus connects all the peripheral. You can see the peripherals here. Like, there are basically two buses. One, there is APB1, which is this one, and this is APB1, and this is APB2. So these are your peripherals, and this bus is responsible for providing clock to these peripherals. There is a mechanism called clock gating, in which we control whether we want to provide clock to individual peripheral or not. So this clock gating mechanism ensures that. Otherwise, what happens is that if you provide clock to all of the peripherals, they will run, and you will have loss of power because of that, because clock costs power if it is a battery operated system. Now we have your APB1 bus, which is responsible for providing clock to these many peripherals. So in code also we have to look accordingly. First of all, if you want to enable any, if you want to access any peripheral, we will have to enable its clock, and then we can write or read onto the pins. So we'll see that in a later part. Now there is one more important thing over here, which is our EHB bus matrix. This is the EHB bus matrix, which is responsible for your arbitration resolution, which it does in a round robin scheme. There are buses which I'll explain here. We'll now look at these: D bus, I bus, and S bus. I bus is basically your instruction bus, which is responsible for fetching the instructions to the code. Next, there is your D bus, which is your decode bus. This provides debug possibilities in the core. And then you have S bus, which is used to access data located in your SRAM, SRAM, or peripheral regions. Then also there is your DMA bus. DMA buses are these. These DMA buses provide you with the direct memory access. So it can be used to access different masters such as your flash, SRAM, and peripherals. Now we'll look what is a master or what is a slave here. Actually, these all are arranged in terms of master slave configuration. So here we will see what is this. As you can see, this is your bus matrix. Here there are multiple masters. So this is a master, the CPU is a master, DMA is a master, DMA2 is a master, and these all are your slaves. So there is a flash, SRAM, SRAM2. So there are two banks of SRAM, and the flash is connected through your accelerator, ART accelerator, that we had discussed in previous slide. Then there are EHB1 peripherals, EHB2 peripherals, FMC, and quad SPI. So these are your slaves, and this matrix is responsible for accessing or kind of providing arbitration resolution. Because if any master wants to access a particular slave, or there can be arbitrations arising, this ensures that this case does not happen. It kind of does a round robin scheduling and provides access of slaves to the masters. If we dig deeper into the CPU, there we have a FPU. This is kind of a coprocessor for floating point based operations. Then there is NVIC, we'll discuss it later, which is nested vector interrupt controller. This is the processor core. Then there is ETM module, which we saw earlier, which is responsible for debug operations. Now there is also debug access port, and this is the bus matrix. Overall, this is the architecture of the CPU. These many blocks are present inside the CPU. So till now we have seen all these yellow marked points that we have discussed so far. So now we will see the memory map, and then we will go through other topics. So this is the memory map of our microcontroller. It can address up to 4 GB of memory. As you can see that it is divided into various sections. The sections for code, there are sections for your CPU with internal peripherals, as well as for the peripherals on the chip. These peripherals are on the CPU, so do not confuse them with this one. Depending upon the boot configuration, which is the status of pins boot 1 and boot 0. This is your boot 0 pin. So based on the status of your boot pins, the microcontroller will either boot from system memory, which is the on-chip bootloader that is present. This is the bootloader firmware that is already factory programmed in every microcontroller. It starts from address 0x1FF000 and it goes up to here. This is contained inside the 28 kilobytes of memory. This is our embedded bootloader, which is a factory program. Next is our flash memory. If you come here in the distributed view, so this is the distributed view of this much memory address. So if you come here, you will see that this is our flash memory, which is contained in this 800 starting from, and 810 it ends. This is exactly if you calculate, it will be equal to 1 MB. You have to just subtract those addresses. It will be 1 MB. Our flash is 1 MB. Then there is this location which is used for remapping, physical remapping of where you want to boot from. So suppose you want to boot from the main flash or embedded SRAM, then you will have to change the boot configuration. For that, the boot configuration will be either 1-1 or this doesn't care, this is don't care, and this will be 0. For that, you will have to set the boot 0 pin to 0 if you want to remap. What will happen, it will directly jump to your particular section of code. Like if you want it to jump to main flash or system or embedded SRAM, so it will directly start executing the code from there. Now if we come to another address, we will find that another block is reserved for your peripherals. It starts from here and goes till here. Here you will see that alternate sections are reserved, and then you have the advanced high performance bus, advanced high performance bus 1 and 2, and then peripheral bus 2 and peripheral bus 1. These are your peripherals. And then the one thing to notice is that the flash and SRAM both are addressable in the same memory space, and also we can physically remap using this configuration that I have already told you. This was the second part of our tutorial in which we covered all these topics. In the next part, we will be taking a deeper dive into the code, vector table, GPIOs, and we will try to blink that LED using the HAL. Till then, see you in the next video. Bye.